America, one of the wealthiest countries in the world. But the question is, how did it accumulate its wealth?
This is a nation founded on genocide and built on the backs of slaves. All right? So we started with a racial problem. We tried to actually eliminate one entire race, and then we used another race to build this country actually quite quickly as a new country into a world power. This country never would have had the wealth that it had it not had slavery for a couple of hundred years.
But I say to white people, look, you didn't do it. They say, yeah, that's right. We didn't have nothing to do with slavery. Yeah, but because of slavery, when you immigrants came here, America was already built with the blood, the sweat of my ancestors. So you got what you got because your fathers gave us what they gave us.
One mistake that's often made is showing how the South, the Confederacy, acquired their wealth off of the backs of our ancestors. And even then, it's reduced to just a few slave owners who saw a real benefit. No. Chattel slavery of blacks benefited the South, but just as much, it benefited the North and all of America and its many European immigrants.
Well, I won't see my longer hair.
America's economic structure was propelled by its dominant export, sold throughout the world, cotton. This one crop provided over half of all U.S. exports earnings. And by 1840, 60% of the world's cotton was grown, picked, and labored over for free by our ancestors. These plantation owners were raking in money, accumulating great wealth, and never having to pay one dime to their laborers. But the North was just as involved. The North developed a variety of businesses that provided services to the slave South, like textile factories, insurance companies, shippers, and cotton brokers. But it doesn't stop at the slave owner or the businesses that provided the services to the slave system. Banks, yes. Bankers on Wall Street made millions selling goods to the South, along with giving loans and creating banks to finance Southern plantations. And much of this same wealth they still have today. Let me give you some examples. J.P. Morgan and Chase Bank admitted that between the years of 1831 to 1865, two of their predecessor banks, Citizens Bank and Canal Bank in Louisiana, accepted 13,000 slaves as collateral on loans that slave masters defaulted. One of the more successful banking families that built much of their wealth on the slave trade was the Brown family, more commonly known as the Brown Brothers and Harriman Company, which is the oldest and largest private investment bank. The Brown Brothers owned hundreds of slaves. This family dominated the cotton industry. They made a huge fortune by lending millions to Southern planters and cotton brokers. Another portion of their wealth came by renting and the sales of slave ships they sold to slave merchants. They served as one of the most important sources of capital in foreign exchange in the U.S. economy. Wachovia Bank, recently acquired by Wells Fargo, also profited heavily off of this cruel system. Mayer Rothschild, a German banker and the founder of the Rothschild banking dynasty, which is believed to have become the wealthiest family in human history, made enormous gains by using our ancestors as collateral. The insurance industry also saw great benefits from slavery. Companies like AIG, Aetna, New York Life were the forerunners in this industry. But see, it's also very important to note that these same plantation owners and business owners would donate large sums of this wealth in order to train their children and the next generation on containing the wealth. For example, Harvard. Harvard was built due to large amounts of money given by Isaac Royall, a plantation owner in the Caribbean islands of Antigua, who made a massive fortune off of his many sugar plantations. Yale was able to build its famous library and establish its prestigious scholarship program. Princeton. By the mid-1700s, many of its students were sons of plantation owners. Brown University. Named after the famous slave owner banker, the Brown Brothers. A large portion of this campus was built with slave labor. And these are just a few of the many institutions that was built with slave money. See, these men would be looked at as great businessmen, philanthropists. But in actuality, they were securing the wealth of their future by training and educating the next generation that would take over their plantations and their businesses, and even become government officials, responsible for creating laws, regulations, and policies that would keep blacks fighting for human rights and access to this stolen wealth for decades. For decades after slavery, blacks have fought against unequal education, which is a sure way of ensuring wealth disparities. We fought grandfather clauses to prevent us from affecting government in ways that could transfer wealth. Land grants, free land issued from the government that blacks were restricted from. The black codes, housing restrictions, redlining and FDA guarantee loans, predatory bank lending, convict leasing, which utilized black labor but does not transfer the wealth. I wish that I could say that this wealth disparity in America was isolated only in America, but it's not.
All the wealth that was generated that helped to make Britain great, so-called, the British Empire, all of this came from enslavement and colonialism and ill-gotten gains. And it links to this modern discussion around inequality and the huge gap between the nations, not only in terms of Britain and Europe, but also the rest of the world, and in particular, Africa and the Caribbean.
The truth is, this is the same scenario across every colonized land. Today, as a people, we fight for the Confederate flags to come down. We even fight for people to stop using the word nigger, right, or other forms of bigotry to not be used. But we've been duped into believing that it's absolutely foolish to continue to fight for reparations. Many of us don't recognize the direct ties between the past and the wealth that was carried into today. Our ancestors were forced to invest in this economy without ever receiving a return. Unlike Jews, reparations were never paid to slaves or their descendants to help balance out this unjustified wealth. But understand that the reason our ancestors were enslaved was not for the purpose of being able to call us a... Right. It was not even for the purpose of being able to raise a slave flag. No. All of the killing, the torturing, dehumanizing, inhumane treatment all boiled down to one reason. Wealth. It was all business. Understand that. I know that our brother Martin did.
I still have a dream.
Not that one.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our checks.